Every month, 40,000 British people travel to Bangkok, the gateway to Thailand. Amongst them this week, the London cabbie who fell in love with a Thai woman, then got the shock of his life. The former dancer who headed east to pirouette with the piranhas. And the woman from Carlisle off to fight in the tense underworld of Thai boxing. 48-year-old ex-taxi driver Mark Cookson from Enfield in North London was looking for a change of scenery when he came to Koh Samui 3 years ago. Marital problems and bankruptcy had left Mark feeling that there was nothing for him in Britain.
Left an ex-wife and two children. She ran off with her boyfriend. It was a lot harder for me to get the children back on a Sunday than it was not to see them. So now I'm 6,000 miles away and it's a lot easier for me to cope with that.
3 years on, Mark is happy and settled with his 30-year-old Thai wife, Christy, who he met in Bangkok.
What do you want to buy? We can buy here very, very cheap. This one came back.
I came to Thailand with £1,500 and walked into a bar and started talking to Christy and basically said she was in Bangkok on holiday. And, I just fucked it, didn't I?
But after 5 days of a full sexual relationship, Christy dropped the bombshell that she had in fact been born a man.
I tell Mark, yes, man. Mark surprised. Mark cried.
I found out and had a heart attack. And I told Christy she had to go and I didn't want to see her anymore and I thought, what the hell have I done? And then a couple of days later I bumped into Christy again and we were talking, we went to have dinner and I thought, well, what the hell, you know? I'm in Thailand and I was happy for that 5 days and that was 3 years ago. Now it isn't, you know, not a problem at all. I didn't tell anybody for a long, long time. And then one guy came that was a friend of my brother. He actually told my sister-in-law. She told my mother. And my mother asked me, is Christy one of those lady men? And I said, yes, she is. Then she said to me, does that mean you're a pufta? And I said, well, no, her body's exactly the same as yours now. I said, but I suppose, I mean, she's a man, so one of us must be gay, but it's not me. And then she told me she had cancer about 2 days later and died. So I wish I'd never told her.
During those 3 years, Mark and Christy have built up Koh Samui's most popular transsexual cabaret bar, where every dancer was once a man.
I hit upon an idea whereas I could take one of the huge big cabaret shows in Bangkok that had coaches coming in every day, but do it very, very small style in the bar. So I built a stage in the bar and I got some of the baby boys that actually live on the island. I got a couple from Bangkok with Christy's friends and we put a little show together. And it's just snowballed from there.
Thailand is famous for its ladyboys, who often seek their fortune by selling their bodies for sex. British men make up a large portion of the clientele.
Oh, there's been loads of people caught out. 50% do it because it's a better way of earning money than picking rice in the fields. 40% do it because they want to do it. And there's about 10% of the ladyboys have actually had more women's hormones than they have men's. And they should have actually been women. But the majority have it done for money.
With ladyboys being a phenomenon in Thailand, it's no surprise that the country has become a mecca for sex change operations.
They can get it done in Hajai, Phuket. At the moment, the best place to do it is in Bangkok. It does a better job and it looks more real. And there's a guy in Hajai that's a lot cheaper, but when you come out, it's like Frankenstein's daughter. And the stitches are in the wrong place and it's the wrong size. So at the moment, they're going to Bangkok.
One of Thailand's most reputable surgeons in this field is Dr. Preacha Tiwa Channon at Bangkok's Bumrungrad Hospital. He's a specialist who's carried out over 1,000 sex change operations over the last 20 years. More than 30 of these have been on patients from the UK.
The Western patients like to come to Thailand. Number one, they saw the patient from Thailand. They see that they got a good result.
The surgeon not only operates to make his patients look like women, but also uses complex surgical procedures to ensure that they feel like women and can have fully functioning sexual relationships with men. This involves removing the penis, but keeping its root, which is used to form a sensitive clitoris. The surgeon also constructs a fully functioning vaginal cavity. The testicles are removed and the surrounding skin is used to form the labia at the base of the vagina. The operation takes 2.5 hours and costs around $5,000.
And the patient can leave the hospital after about 5 days, and they need another 6 weeks to recuperate. After operation, they just look at the mirror. They look every day, they clean up every day, they look at themselves, they're very happy. All the patients, they're very happy with the operation.
And Christy, who had her operation 8 years ago, is no exception to that.
But when I wake up in the hospital, I'm crying, I'm very crying because I'm so happy that I'm ready, 100%.
Business is so good at Christy's bar, they're hoping to expand, and Mark has been given an offer he can't refuse.
The guy who owns the band actually came to me because Christie's is a big name on Koh Samui, everybody knows it, wants me to come on this plot of land to build a cabaret, but a much bigger one and more elaborate than the other one, and then he can sell the rest of the land around it much easier, and he gave me a really good deal on it. It's going to be one of the biggest bars on the island, will be one of the biggest bars outside of the club. Prime location.
It's a new bar. Gathoi bar, lady boy bar is a new coming soon, about 2 more months. We'll be there to see cabaret show.
With the cabaret business going from strength to strength, Mark's clearly happy with both his business and personal life with Christy.
If I went anywhere now, if I went to live in Australia or I went back to England for a holiday, Christy would go with me, for sure. I mean, if I took Christy anywhere else in the world, nobody would know it's a man. No one would question her sexuality. And even if they did question it, I've got not one problem with it whatsoever. I mean, I've lived with it for 3 years, and to me, it's a woman. Maybe I am gay now, but in a different sort of way. It doesn't affect me in the least. You know? You only live once.
For when all the hair falls out.
Fuck up!
Fuck off.
Another British man who's managing to make a living in Thailand from the tourist industry is former Birmingham ballet dancer Anthony Griffiths, who came to the island of Koh Tao and started a new life as a diving instructor.
You can make any sentence that you want. It's to remember the order of how you check the gear. The best one here at the moment is bring weed, grizzlies and fags. That's the one we like. Yeah. Or big willy, really off fun. Big willies relieve anal frustration.
Came to Koh Tao originally for 1 week. This is about 6 years ago, and we came for 1 week to do a dive course, and that first time ended up staying here for 6 months. Ever since, I've been coming back every year for like 6 months, 8 months, 9 months. I've been here now 14, 15 months. I'd been a dancer in London, that's how I started life out at 16. Very lucky, got plucked from obscurity, went to an audition in London very young and got my chance. And there I was, 16, 17, in London, dancing. For 10 years I did this. Then after this, I just felt a need to find a new direction, that sort of thing that gives you the little spring in your heel. It's difficult to describe the feeling you get from diving. I started 5, 6 years ago now, and the minute I took my first breath underwater and wanted to be an instructor, just straight away, I immediately found something new. As soon as I put my face in the water, I just felt completely at home there. For 10 years, I've been striving as a dancer to break free of gravity, which is what dancing's all about. It's being able to defy gravity and make it look easy. I'll do some jetés or pirouettes or put my legs in second position and you can just hold the position because the water's carrying all of your body weight. You feel at one with the environment you're in. You feel close to it. And then when you see something awesome like 2,000 meter drops, like a vertical wall, straight down to the abyssal plain, coming through really awesome passages, drifting with like rays the size of just huge, like 5 meter wingspan, just flying through the air. It's like going to the zoo and getting in the cage with the animal. You can't describe it, you can't put it into words what that feels like. So for me, diving is life, I suppose.
Nice. Perfect.
Everyone you meet every day is happy. They're on holiday. They're spending money here. You know, they want it. So they're not. You're not dealing with miserable people for a start, which we all know, guys. 9 to 5, 5 days a week in London, just to pay to live in that system and that society.
I'm just doing fine. And all you boys at home in that crappy job. Sorry, guys. Do you know what I mean?
Know what I mean? Monday morning. Monday morning.
That's where I live, that's the FT. Living next door is a German guy and his girlfriend. They make a lot of noise when they shag.
And you don't?
We make more. We make a lot more noise.
My girlfriend and I met now about 3 months ago. Her name's Mo, she's 25.
Hello, England.
Mom, this is Mo. We're coming back in October. November, we'll see you then.
Now I'm really starting to think about children and stuff now because I'm 33. It's unbelievable, isn't it? I know. 33, I am. I want to get married. That's what I really want to do. And have kids. And I think I found the right one. You have to meet the right person. I truly believe that. And I believe I've been fortunate enough to meet the right person for me. And hopefully I'm good enough for her. And she'll say yes one day. Life's looking good. I've been lucky. I got dealt a few good cards. But I believe you make your own luck in this world.
So it looks like it's going to be a little longer before Anthony returns to Birmingham. Coming up after the break, the kickboxer who's heading east for the biggest fight of her life.
Sneller dan het licht in zijn strijd tegen het kwaad. Stille getuige is zijn schaduw. Alec Baldwin is The Shadow, morgen om 8:30.
Kom ook naar Heineken Nightlife. Bel voor kaarten 0900 300 1250.
Short is a 24-year-old single mother from Carlisle. She's preparing to fly to Bangkok with her trainer Mike Haslam to fight for an international Thai boxing title.
It's a dream that I've always wanted to go there, and now I'm getting the chance to go and now going to compete in the championships. Training for 3 years as a Thai boxer, been competing last 2 years. I've had 7 fights. Hopefully a lot more to come as well. I got into Thai boxing because I used to be a bit of a bad lass going around, like, fighting a bit. It got to a stage where I was going out every weekend, and there wasn't a weekend where I wasn't getting into trouble. Started training and never really been in bother since.
Mike runs the Dragons Gym in Carlisle. He's a veteran of 156 fights and has made many trips to Thailand over the last 12 years to study the 2,000-year-old sport.
Thai boxing is one of the hardest ring sports in the world. It's 5 3-minute rounds of non-stop action. You can use your arms, you can use your elbows, you can use your knees, and you can use your feet.
Jackie has spent the last 2 months training with Mike in preparation for what will be the biggest fight of her career.
My name is Jackie Shaw, I'm a Thai boxer. I'm going to the Women's World Championships in Thailand, and I'm ready.
Jackie finally arrives in Bangkok after a grueling 24-hour journey via Dubai.
Right, well, I'm finally here at last. It's hard to describe what I feel like. I am very nervous, but I always am anyways. But also I'm excited to, I want to get out there and see what I can do, how I'm training, if I've improved. I want to go to the top and I won't stop till I get there.
Having caught up on her jet lag, Jackie heads off with Mike to begin her first day's training in a traditional Thai gym. It's 91 degrees in the shade.
I've been coming here for about 10 years now. First time Jackie's been to this gym. I'm sat up today, just some skipping, shadow boxing, hard work, maybe bad work, and leave it at that for today. She's still getting acclimatised to the weather.
It's red hot. It's absolutely boiling, and we're under corrugated iron. Shit myself. I'm nervous. I don't want some music on. Oh my god.
In the traditional Muay Thai gym, the women are not allowed to train in the ring. It's taboo. Keep that pace all the time.
Feet are on fire because it's just concrete floor. So apart from being hot, your feet are burning. Just keep warm water on your head. Give you time to get your breath back, but it's very hard.
The young kids when they're training, we've got to be on toes all the time. So what they do, they chalk the heels of the children. The heels touch the floor, they get a whack with the stick. So they learn very quickly, believe me. Well, then, first day over. What do you reckon?
I'll go home. No, it's alright.
You've got to acclimatise. It takes at least a week.
It's not so bad now, it's gone nice and cool.
That's why they have the tin roof, because the sun hits the tin. Well,
I thought that'd make it worse.
Tin roof, that's what it does. It keeps the heat, so that makes you stronger. Makes you weaker when you train, but when you fight, you go back to England and train, you'll train twice as hard.
With the first training session completed, Jackie, Mike and their party head off to one of Bangkok's nightly Thai boxing shows.
So this is behind the scenes at Ratchadam Nern, Thailand's biggest stadium. This is where all the fighters are prepared and bandaged up. As soon as they're bandaged up and rubbed down with oil, penetrates the muscle and it takes a lot of the sting out of your opponent's kick.
The first two rounds of the five-round fights are almost used as an exhibition to help the spectators choose who they'll bet on. The final three see some serious action.
First time I've been here, especially seeing the fighting. I've seen it on tape, but totally different to what I expected. I'm starting to panic now for my own fight because, I mean, these are professionals and they're out of breath, so I was going to have to train harder because I'm going to be knackered, basically.
Jackie's trip has been largely sponsored by Mike. He's investing in her now because if she wins the Intercontinental title, she could turn professional and be paid to fight all over the world. In the meantime, she's got to get stuck into 4 weeks of extremely tough training.
Today, I'm really, really sore. My ribs, my stomach. And everything. We nearly cried yesterday, but we never actually broke down. It's just getting harder. But I'm just so sore now, I'm getting sore. Mike as a trainer, me and him have some corker arguments. I mean, it's unbelievable because he knows boxing is my life and he knows I want to get to the top.
We've had our ups and downs. She wants to fight it. In Thailand, she just has to listen to me and me alone.
But it's very hard training. I mean, be whacked and smacked and kicked. But it's been all right. Just something I have to get used to.
After a month of grueling training, it's an hour before the start of Jackie's big fight. Her training has also included two warm-up fights with Thai girls, which she's won, leaving her feeling confident. When she gets to the stadium, the organisers mysteriously skip the weigh-in of both Jackie and her opponent.
Nervous is out now, but I'm glad. I like being nervous. So butterflies are there now, just waiting to meet my fighter. No, my lovely bloody honey monster will come flying through the doors or something.
Unfortunately for Jackie, this joke about her opponent proves to be somewhat prophetic. As she begins her final preparations for the fight, the mysterious absence of a weigh-in suddenly begins to make sense.
Well, that's Jackie's opponent over there in the red. She looks fairly technical. She's a big girl.
She's big, really big. She's about, we all think she's about 65 kilos. She's a lot taller. She's got legs like tree trunks. No wonder they didn't want to weigh in. I know now, but I thought bigger lasses. They'll go down the same way.
It's finally time for the big fight, and the controversy over the apparently heavier opponent is temporarily forgotten as Jackie focuses her mind on one thing, winning.
Want a kiss all the time. Right, listen, mate. Don't take your eyes off her. Every time, look for that jaw, look for that body with the punches. Just watch them knees come at you and watch them legs.
I'm not worried about her boxing. Thais aren't good at boxing, but I know she's good on the grapple and the knees, so just to watch for them.
I'm not scared of fighting anyone or anything like that. There's one thing I'm scared of is losing. I've never lost, and that's what I'm really scared of. I never want to lose. I'm going to win tonight. When I'm fighting, I always hear your corner man, right? You can never really hear the crowd unless you're whacking one, and then there's an uproar, and you think, yes, I'll do a bit more. You shouldn't really, but I always try and hurt the lass. I mean, she could be the nicest lass in the world, and they always are. I mean, afterwards you get to meet them, and they're really nice. Well, if I win, or should I say, when I win, I'll become the Intercontinental Champion. If I lose, I might as well just throw myself in the sea or something.
As the fight ends, Mike and the crowd have Jackie the clear winner. But to everyone's amazement, the judges think differently.
Never been stitched up. Crowd saying she won it. The Thai judges going to the Thai. Still, Jackie was the aggressor to the end. She won four rounds out of five rounds. I'm not happy with that.
Absolutely, but it felt like I was totally robbed. I thought I got it. Totally sick. I feel like I've wasted everyone's time. Mike wants it over in England for a rematch. No, I fucking won it, like, and I've just sworn it, haven't
I? Come on.
Like I said before, I was scared of losing, and it's happened, and never want it to happen again, basically, because I feel absolutely shit. But there you go, it's the name of the game.
And again!
Back training in a couple of weeks, and here we go again. Oh, I've got a good few years left in this. I won't be going anywhere yet.
Jackie's trainer, Mike, is currently negotiating a rematch.
Leed, maar ook.
Every week, 10,000 people from Britain travel to Bangkok, the gateway to Thailand. Amongst them this week, the couple heading to the island of Koh Samui to celebrate and to grieve, and the man who's leaving his wife behind to visit his Thai lover. Angela and John Fawcett from Darlington are planning a trip to the island of Koh Samui in southern Thailand to attend the wedding of their daughter Emma.
Emma is our youngest daughter who is getting married on Valentine's Day to Lek. Lek is Thai and Emma's known him for about 4 years. She met him in a nightclub in Thailand. She wrote this postcard telling Mum all about Lek and how she'd fallen madly in love, and she just kept going back to Thailand for the holidays. And then 4 years ago, Emma decided she was going to stay in Thailand. She got a job in the restaurant where Lek works, and then Emma got pregnant.
2 years ago, the Fawcett's elder daughter, Karen, went to visit Emma and Lek in Thailand, despite suffering from an all-too-common illness.
Karen suffered for 10 years with anorexia, and she struggled for these 10 years. She tried so hard. But on the 4th of December, I got the phone call to say that Karen wasn't well and that she'd been taken into hospital. That was on the Sunday. But then on the Tuesday, Emma rang and she said, "I've got some bad news, Mum. Karen isn't coming home. She's got into a coma." John and I flew out to Koh Samui and had 2 hours with Karen before she died. On her death certificate, it's brain damage due to kidney and liver failure. When you're sick continually, day in and day out, it affects you. And your liver and your kidneys can only stand so much. And in the end, they're just packed up. And it is very, very, very sad.
Karen was cremated at a Buddhist temple near Surat Thani, a half-day's journey from Koh Samui. The couple want to visit the temple while they're in Thailand and pay their respects.
John hasn't been back to Thailand since Karen's death. He's going to be very, very sad.
It's so hard to go back. I want to go back. It's going to bring back a lot of memories, you say, you know, and I just don't... Well, I don't know what I want.
I know it's sad that there's going to be one of us missing. It's very sad, but Emma's big day can't be spoiled.
So it's with mixed emotions that the couple prepare for their journey. John and Angela arrive in Koh Samui a week before Emma gets married. They plan to visit the temple where their other daughter Karen was cremated after the wedding.
I just don't feel as if I've come to a wedding. I just feel that I'm on my holidays. It's a good feeling, really, because if I was at home, I'd be that stressed out and smoking that many cigarettes because I'd be wondering, is the cake done? Is the car's ready? Is this ready? Is that ready? But because Emma's done it all, I don't have any of that. Emma's got all the stress, not her mum.
Emma works on the island as a British Airways rep, and fiancé Lek is a barman. The couple share the job of looking after baby Aisha. The final preparations for Emma's wedding are hampered by the weather. In the south of Thailand, which includes Koh Samui, the northeast monsoon season stretches from November to January, when, even though the weather is warm, heavy rainfall is a part of life. This year, the season has lasted longer than usual.
I should have gone this way. Oh, well.
Is there another way to go?
You're just going to have to keep going.
No way, because the business is the other way.
No. Like that hanging on.
Oh, it's lovely.
It's, I think, just a little bit too big here.
And you know, you can take that bow off, Emma.
So, and we'll take it off for the evening.
If you have a British Airways do, you've got a beautiful dress to wear. Yeah.
It's the morning of Emma's wedding and a ceremony that will mix English and Buddhist traditions.
It's 6:30 in the morning. And there's a clear sky and there's no rain. We were sat here last night, we just thought there was not going to be a wedding. But as today, the sun is coming up and it's going to shine on Emma.
Hello.
I'd just like to make a little speech just to thank everybody for coming today. I mean, so many people have come from so far. It really does touch me that everybody could come today. To my mum and dad, I'd just like to say that I'm sorry that you saw a funeral before you saw a wedding.
Don't say where?
I know. 1 minute. I'd just like to say that I'm just happy that everybody could be here. And this one's for you, Mum and Dad. Cheers.
All the best ever in life.
Ever in life.
John? Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Yeah.
With the wedding ceremony over, John and Angela set off on the emotional journey to Suratani. The last time they made this trip was on the day of Karen's funeral. It's been almost 2 years since her death, and the couple are still having difficulty coming to terms with their loss.
Even though I was the one that said, yes, switch the machine off, even though I was the one that had to switch the machine off, it did not sink into here that she'd died. I'm the strong one. One of us had to be strong, and it wasn't John. One of us had to organise everything, and John just absolutely and totally fell to pieces. Karen's death is the only time I've seen him cry.
Crematorium where she was cremated. Oh. And this is the temple where all the prayers were set for her. I wanted to come, but never be the same again, will it? But one life ended here and one life's begun here, and we've got to accept that, haven't we? Bye, Karen. I'm glad I've been. I had to come just to see it for one more time.
Coming up after the break, the man who's leaving his wife at home and going to visit his lover. In the sleepy village of Underbelly in Devon, 63-year-old jeweller Gavin Poulton is preparing for his 20th trip to Thailand.
3 pairs of trousers, and I'm sure that'll be one too many.
He's going to buy jewellery to sell in Britain and to visit his Thai business partner. Catherine, who's been married to Gavin for 40 years, will be staying at home in England.
I suppose in a way I'm envious of him going away. Whilst at the same time, I don't mind. I'm quite looking forward to being on my own for a month.
Gavin and Catherine were married for 20 years, until Gavin, in his early 40s, realised he was bisexual. Today, he and Catherine are still together, yet have what is best termed as an open relationship.
This is my partner, who I hope is running part of my business in Thailand. Here's a more sexy photograph of him. He wanted to pose in front of the camera. He wanted to look as sexy as possible.
As well as being his business partner, 28-year-old Lex is also Gavin's lover. While Gavin is with Lex in Thailand, Catherine will be making the most of Gavin's absence.
I suppose one could say that I've taken advantage of it and had my men friends and enjoyed myself that way. So being without Gavin is fine by me, and if I want to be alone, I will. But it's nice to know that there is a gentleman friend somewhere whose company I can call on, who might call in and have coffee.
Right.
Bye-bye.
See you in a month's time.
Take care.
After a grueling flight, Gavin's plane has touched down in Bangkok, but Lex hasn't come to meet him.
It's usual having him around, and I like him in bed with me, but I don't mind whether he comes or whether he doesn't come. It wasn't exactly my first experience with a gay sexual contact. I met a really beautiful young lady in the Bois de Boulogne in Paris. I thought she was a prostitute, so we went a few hundred yards off the road. I was fondling her breasts and feeling her bottom and kissing and cuddling. By the time I got down to feeling her legs and putting my hand between them, I found she got a cock as well. And it really was the most exciting few seconds of my life. I wasn't shocked after he'd knelt down and fellated me. We went back to the road and I offered him money, but he refused to take it. So he was there just for the excitement in the same way that I had been there just for the excitement. There's a large proportion of people who will say they're shocked by my attitude, but would secretly like to behave in the same way. I'm absolutely convinced of it.
Gavin has rented a flat on the west bank of Bangkok's main river.
Yeah, over there.
Yeah.
My attraction for Lex is more to do with business than it is to do with a physical relationship. Lex likes me because I'm more wealthy than he is. If somebody says they like me, I never know whether they like me for my money or for my face or for the size of a cock. I just take it all as superficial, just get as much enjoyment out of it as I can. This is the entrance to my apartment block.
Unbeknown to Gavin, he's about to be reunited with his Thai lover, who's been waiting for several hours.
Ah! I wondered if you would be waiting for me.
I've already alarmed.
I ring and ring and ring. Where's your telephone?
No. I can close.
You close the telephone? Yeah, that's why I didn't see you. And this young man is, I must introduce you. He's a cameraman for English television.
Oh, no.
So now you'll be on the English television. Okay, I like your hair, too. Hey, you look good.
Thank you.
There's another surprise waiting upstairs for Gavin. Lex hasn't come to Bangkok alone. At Gavin's apartment, which only has one bedroom, Lex has brought along half his family.
From 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 minutes.
Yeah. It is very difficult to understand that when I arrange to meet Lex, he turns up with his mother and two cousins. But one just has to accept that, because that is the way people behave. He's looking well, yes. There's no problems with him at all. In fact, he's looking better because he's cut his hair now and not quite so long as it was. Am I the same as last time I was in Bangkok?
Yes.
You said I am more fat?
Yes, now you're fat. You're very young. It's number one. Much hair tomorrow.
Bex likes me to be smooth-faced. Catherine, she likes me to have whiskers, so I grow it again in England. Lex becomes very excited if I play with his nipples. This evening I shall be sleeping. This evening there's no plans for catching up. We'll be catching up over the next week or month.
Gavin and Lex have spent a couple of days catching up and are now heading off to a jewellery wholesaler's.
When I met Lex, it's fair to say that he was making ends meet, but he wasn't particularly solvent. I felt that he was a good salesman. He could sell, I could see that. So I allowed him to buy jewellery on my business account in
Bangkok to try the market in Thailand. That started about 2 years ago. The business in Thailand is a partnership. It's almost exclusively run by him. It's just that I financed it. He's experienced some success with it, but I don't know exactly how successful it is, and that's one of the reasons I'm following him around the various places to see how he does the business.
Tucked away down a tiny alleyway, Gavin and Lex eventually find the shop they're looking for.
Look at it. I mean, just look at the amount of stock they've got here. And to look in every box would take me 2 days.
Gavin is losing patience.
I think I'm not buying anything at all. I am not going to spend all day looking through here, and then we go to another two shop and I do the same thing. Because the money for me is so small. Yeah, so it's better that we do not do it anymore. I get on very well with Lek, but one of the problems is that if I go in and buy $1,000 worth of silver and he is with me, he undoubtedly will see things that he could also sell, and he always wants to stick it onto my bills. So I walked out of the shop because it means that he's still in there and he's going to have to pay for that jewellery that he buys himself.
Gavin decides to call his wife.
Is that Catherine? Oh, I'm sorry, you sounded very young, I must say. I've just come out of one shop and I feel sort of a bit hot and sticky and fed up.
Sometimes he can ring for Catherine. I don't want to see, I don't want to know, I don't want to hear. Sometimes I tell it, sometimes okay.
Yeah, okay, I'm glad you're okay. Bye. But I think you're angry with me because you,
No, I'm not angry with you.
Gavin and Lex have left Bangkok and are en route to Lex's parents. They've driven 650 kilometres south of Bangkok to Chaiar, a small town where Lex's uncle owns a beer garden, complete with female entertainment.
I quite like seeing young ladies in short skirts singing, so I enjoy staying here for a night.
Though once again, Gavin and Lex have little privacy.
Lex would like to go to sleep at 3 o'clock every morning, and I don't want to. So the relationship between Lex and I is like any other marriage. There is frictions and strains there. But by and large, we seem to get on all right together.
The next morning, Gavin and Lex rise early and go to bathe in a hot volcanic pool. In this tranquil setting, Gavin is thinking about the effect Thailand has on his health.
I'm open to a lot more diseases out here than the Thais are. But unless I actually pick up a bug and become infected in my stomach, I find that the diet I have here makes my... If you're filming this, I'll put it neat, nicely. My stools more solid than they are in England. Twenty years ago, if I'd have seen Lek in his swimming trunks, I would have had an erection. There's no doubt about it. He's physically attractive. But then so are horses and dogs. I mean, I'm not just attracted to physically attractive boys. Well, I'm 63 now, and I really don't feel that sex is terribly important anymore.
Oh, God, more.
I just want the company of somebody who I find attractive. When I was 40, if I look you in your swimming costume,
yes,
then Gavin Cock come up. Okay, but now Gavin older.
Yes.
And okay, I look you, you same person, very beautiful, but Cock not come up. Okay.
Okay.
I really don't understand the meaning of the word love. I've had an extremely passionate feelings, which I would suppose must be love for three people. A young ladyboy called Mu in Thailand, an English antique dealer, cum jeweler, and my wife's sister originally.
Mu was Gavin's first Thai lover. After meeting him in Bangkok, Gavin fell in love and visited him a number of times over the next 2 years. the relationship began to fall apart in July 1990, when Moore arrived in the UK with serious health worries.
As there was the AIDS scare at that time, this is maybe 6 or 7 years ago, he and I were both tested for HIV. It turned out that Moo was positive, I was negative, and because I value my marriage to Catherine more than I value my relationships with other people, I terminated the relationship with Moo.
Because of the risk that Gavin could still develop HIV in the months after his test, he stopped sleeping with his wife.
We never really developed a sexual relationship again. She's been seeing this man now for about 4 or 5 years, I think. They seem to be content with each other, and she is also content with me.
Finally, the couple arrive at Lex's parents' house. Lex's family are wealthy by Thai standards, owning local orchards and rubber plantations, and they feel genuinely honoured to have Gavin stay with them.
When I'm here, I usually sleep with Lex in a semi-private part of the house, but we very rarely ever have any sexual congress in the house, mainly because there is no privacy in Thai houses. You never know when children are going to walk in. My relationship with everybody in the house is good, particularly with Lex's father, who makes an effort to be friendly towards me. The family know that Lex is gay. They know that Lex did some ladyboy shows when he was very young. I am pleased that they accept me as the friend of Lex. My relationship with Lex, it's a relationship for me for pleasure. I'd like to see him develop his business more. But I don't want to be, I don't want to feel committed to him, I don't want to feel that he's committed to me either. You viewers can make your own mind up about how maybe you think Catherine should behave towards me, or I should behave towards her, but we have found our own way of living, and we're still married, you know, after 40 years. There's a lot of you out there who aren't.
Sadly, a month after Gavin returned to Britain, he received the tragic news that Lex had been murdered during a robbery in his home village. On Bangkok Bound next week, a Brighton man goes off to reap rewards from Thailand's sex industry, and a Colchester woman goes on a journey she's yearned to make for 57 years. British people every day are bound for Bangkok, the gateway to Thailand. On the programme this week, two vastly contrasting expeditions.
Cameras, handbags, tissues,
massage oil,
umbrella, raincoat,
insulin shower,
hot brush,
a camera.
First, there's the man off to immerse himself in Thailand's sex industry, and the woman off to the grave of her father who never returned from World War II. In the heart of Brighton on England's south coast, Adrian Smale is planning a business trip to Thailand. He won't be packing any suits for his trip, and there won't be a briefcase in sight, because in his line of business, he doesn't need them.
I'll take pictures of naked girls.
Clean hair, mate.
I like girls. I mean, that is a prime motivation. I get on with girls, and I think I can bring the best out of them. Well, I guess it's a dream of any guy to actually do this job.
Bend over the table. That's good.
That's it.
Adrian is in a hurry to finish this British shoot before he leaves for Bangkok.
So good.
Connell has a dirty bum.
He's going to Thailand for the third time to shoot pictures on spec that he hopes to sell to regular clients such as Razzle and Club International magazine.
Super. I can't imagine anything I'd rather do. And that includes being on stage in a rock band or, you know, starring in a film.
Unlike the shoots he does in the UK, Adrian will have no assistance or lights in Thailand, and instead of having an agent to find the girls to photograph, he'll have to track them down himself.
Baby lotion. Every glamour photographer should have a camera.
In order to cover his costs of around £2,000 and have money left over to pay himself a wage, he needs to return with at least 5 shoots on film. Although confident in his camera skills, the real mission is to find enthusiastic models.
Well, it's a taxi. Bangkok Bound.
Safely arrived in Bangkok, Adrian embarks on a 3-hour cab journey. His destination, Pattaya, a sex tourist playground where a large proportion of Thailand's estimated 250,000 prostitutes work. Adrian has found that there's an increasing demand for soft porn photos of Thai women who are seen as exotic by Western magazine editors. He's hoping to persuade some of these women to pose in front of his camera.
For glamour photography, they've got absolutely the perfect body. The way their bum comes out, the curves. They've just got incredible boobs.
Thai bar girls are cheaper than British models. Adrian only has to pay them £70 a shoot, as opposed to £300 back home. If the photos turn out well, the magazines will pay up to £1,000 for each set of 100 prints.
I've got my lighter and I can't get it back. And there's no way I'm foraging around in a 14-year-old's cleavage, you know what I mean? Not even for a film crew.
Adrian is offered full sex by a young bar girl for the equivalent of only £3.
She was old enough to shoot. She says she's 20, but I reckon she's about 13.
Although Thailand is notorious for sex tourism, most British holidaymakers don't realise that prostitution is technically illegal here. However, prosecution is rare as long as the prostitute is 18 or over. The industry feeds off local men too. It's estimated that 3 out of 4 single Thai men regularly use prostitutes. On his first night, Adrian manages to find 2 bar girls who are not underage to model for him.
Okay, if you lie down on the bed.
Adrian trained at Chelsea Art College and 2 years ago began applying his training to the world of glamour photography.
No more. If you're trying to fill a frame, more. It almost becomes that abstract art. Okay, I know that sounds absolutely ridiculous because, you know, at the end of the day, I'm a porn photographer.
The shoot goes well until it's time to pay the girls.
Well, I just finished the shoot, took the girls downstairs. I started on by the security guards because I didn't have enough money to pay them. It was a mouthful really because I spent the money on a fake Rolex earlier. The guards threatened to do me basically if I didn't pay the girls their money. I'm going to meet the girls downstairs at 9 o'clock tomorrow. If I'm not there, I'm going to be physically torn from my bed, I would imagine. I'm going to spend all night trying to find cash machines that will give me money. The last one was out of service. I'm praying this one's not. Man! The quest for the Grail goes on. It's counting.
Yes!
The next day, Adrian comes across a girl in a massage parlour he thinks is stunning. At first, he has trouble persuading her to pose for him, but eventually she agrees and goes back to his hotel room. The majority of prostitutes he's approached so far have been reluctant to model for him, even though the money he's offering is equivalent to sleeping with up to 7 punters. For most of them, opening their legs on camera is further than they're prepared to go. Adrian's latest model is no exception.
The girl's just left in a huff. Had to ask her to open her legs to start the shoot. And then she started putting her hands between the legs, going, no, no, no.
Awful.
I've never felt like a dirty old man before doing this. Because it's always so consensual. Even the time I came to Thailand before, I knew every single girl was up for it and they wanted to do it. But she had a kind of innocent air about her that I didn't really want to corrupt. So it was just very, very difficult to try and make her understand what I was trying to do. That's all I want to say.
The day has been a disaster for Adrian. The pressure is now on to find enough girls to break even. Adrian's luck is changing. He's received a tip-off about two other girls that he finds rather exciting.
These girls actually do a lesbian show in one of the go-go bars. What I'm going to try and do is get them to do the actual lesbian show in the room. I'm just going to shoot around it and try and get shots that I could sell in the UK.
So once again, Adrian's back at work, pounding the streets of Pattaya, trying to track down the lesbians. And on the other side of town, another Westerner is at work dealing with the fallout from the popularity of the sex industry. Sister Joan left her native island in 1958 and works in a Pattaya day centre for street children, run by an order of Catholic nuns. The sheer numbers of sex tourists who flock to Pattaya from around the world make it a potentially dangerous place for young children. Around 100 infants come here every day. Some of their parents work in the sex trade.
Every morning at 9:30. They stay from 9:30 until 3:30. Now they do their meditation, their quiet period, when they close their eyes and just stay quiet within themselves.
Pattaya is known for a lot of sex tourism. So children who wander around the beaches during the day are really at risk. There are people around there who are interested in, well, sex with children, and they offer money to the children to either do masturbation for them or whatever. There are always older children who have learned, you know, what to do, and they will teach the younger children how to do it, and whatever the money that's given to the younger child, well, then they get a cut in it. By having the children in our centres during the day, we feel that this is a protection for them.
Hopefully that nothing destructive will happen between now and tomorrow morning when they come back again.
As night falls in Pattaya, the streets around the bars where Adrian searches for his models are teeming with children who are rubbing shoulders with sex tourists. Even though the Thai government has recently introduced tougher sentences for paedophiles, the danger remains. Adrian only ever shoots girls who can prove they're 18 or over. Before starting work to find the lesbians, he decides to sample some international cuisine.
What I always say is, when in Thailand, eat as the Italians do.
Right, it's me stocked up on my carbohydrates. Just going to find these dirty bitches.
10 minutes later, he finds the women he's been looking for. He has to pay each girl the equivalent of £10 to release them from the bar where they work.
Deal on the bar fine for both girls. That looks like a shoe is definitely on.
I'm well up for this. Is this going to happen?
That's it. Good. Look at these girls.
Yes.
I'm really, really happy I found them. I'm not hardly paying them any money whatsoever. So chuffed. Just going to keep shooting, and hopefully they will get quite carried away.
I suppose when it boils down to it, they would rather be messing around with one of their best friends rather than some big fat 50-year-old tourist.
Okay, smile at me.
Oh, man. Oh, what a relief. I cannot tell you how well that shoot went. It's the first time I've smiled since I've been here, I think.
Happy with his day's work, Adrian gives himself his first night off.
Head's absolutely banging. Got drunk as a skunk last night. Think I may have... Well, anyway, I woke up with a girl this morning. she's gone there. I can't quite remember what happened, to be honest.
Over the next few days, Adrian managed to get two more shoots in with girls who didn't want to appear in front of our camera, so he's on the home straight.
Got to try and get one more shoot up in Bangkok before I go home, and it would have been a fruitful journey.
Adrian is on a mission to find an upfront girl for his final shoot.
I'm looking for girls with real expression, real personality. And if I have one that actually comes up to me, pins me up against the wall, and says I want to fuck you, that is the sort of girl I need.
He's in the Nana Plaza area of Bangkok, one of the city's three main red light districts.
I'm up for it. I'm up for it big time. And white shield for a minute.
Direct sales techniques come into force here. The girls don't hold back. They spot their prey and go for it. Never afraid to make the first move and tailoring their patter to fit in with the punter.
Why? I'm from London.
A couple of hours later, Adrian finally manages to get a girl to pose for him.
Now on to get like this. Back.
When you're shooting girls that can't speak a lot of English, you kind of have to go into this really camp routine.
Hard work being a model.
You're mimicking their body movements to make them feel relaxed. You have to do the poses for them so they can see exactly what you can do.
Like that.
By the end of these shoots, I'm acting more like a girl than they are. And, which is a bit worrying. Look when you me. Have to go out to a bar afterwards.
Adrian now has his five shoots in the bag and can now go home to get the films developed. 2 weeks later, at home in Brighton, and Adrian's happy.
Yeah, they look fine. If every set comes out like this, I'm quitting.
But in the meantime, it's back to the grindstone.
Look at me.
All right, Monday morning, back to work. Good old English wife swapper shoot. That's it.
After the break, the woman on a pilgrimage she's longed to make for 57 years. Pub landlady Shirley Jerome from Colchester in Essex is planning a pilgrimage to Thailand. Shirley's father served in the Second World War. he was captured by the Japanese and sent to a prison camp in Thailand to build the notorious death railway leading to Burma.
I was 6 months when he was called up. He was quite sad when he had to go off, obviously, and leave me and my mum behind. And then in 1942, my mother had a letter to say that he was missing. They weren't sure whether he was dead or what had happened, but when the war was over and the letter came to say that he wouldn't be coming home because he had died in the prison camp of malnutrition, dysentery, and all these other horrible diseases that he got out there.
He was only 25 years old when he died, and was one of 24,000 British soldiers who didn't return home from the camps there. Shirley's always wanted to visit his grave. Finally, her dream is about to come true.
I just wanted to go there so I could stand there and think, well, I've done it. I've been out here and I've seen where he's laid at rest.
Shirley's just inherited a small amount of money that has paid for her trip on the annual British Legion pilgrimage to Thailand.
I thought, right, this is the opportunity. I'm now going to go on my trip of a lifetime. I will be emotional and I'll be thinking, you shouldn't be in there, you should be with me. I miss a father. If you haven't ever had a father, you don't know what you've missed out on, but you just think of things that you think, well, that would have been a lot different if my dad had been here. I could have shared that with him.
That's all I want to say is Thailand, here I come.
I'm really looking forward to it, but also I'm getting nervous. It's going to be quite a dramatic event when I get there.
Shirley and the rest of the British Legion party have arrived. The plan is to spend a few days enjoying the sights of the city before making the three-hour journey north to the cemetery. Shirley's first impressions are not entirely favourable.
It's a little bit more shabbier than I thought it was.
Despite the temperature being 92 degrees in the shade, Shirley plans to visit some tourist sites as she mentally prepares to finally see her father's grave.
I am very apprehensive at the moment, but I'm not going to let it dampen my trip to Bangkok.
Bangkok's famous for its markets, which are packed with counterfeit goods. Shirley's on the hunt for music by her favourite star.
Cliff Richards, no Cliff.
Originally a haven for backpackers, the country has increasingly geared up for the more conventional and often more mature holidaymaker.
If anyone ever said to me I'd be riding an elephant, I would never believe it. It's lovely up there. Slightly bumpier than the coach. My father would think if he knew I was out here. I don't, honest. We'll be off to the cemetery tomorrow. Hopefully, not too emotional, but I don't know about that. If I do, I do.
It's the morning Shirley has been building up to for 57 years.
I don't know why I'm putting this on, but my father didn't believe in makeup. Apparently, so my mother said she never wears any.
Never?
Never.
After a 3-hour coach journey, the British Legion party arrive at the Kanchanaburi War Cemetery, where more than 3,500 British soldiers are buried.
Thank you.
in her heart, you are still alive. Your dear wife, Irene, constantly talks about you. You're never from our thoughts. And I'm sure she'll be thinking of you today. Because I've come on her behalf, as well as for my own benefit. The last thing I wanted to do was pay my respects to you.
He would have loved me more than anything in the world because I was the only thing he ever wrote about. I was his baby and that's all he cared. I'm sure that he would be really over the moon if he knew I was here. Tomorrow I'm leaving Thailand and it will be a very sad occasion because I'm going to leave behind lots of memories and I should be feeling very sad inside. There's nothing out in this world that means anything more than being able to come over here and pay my respects. After 57 years, it's got to be some kind of achievement.
Bye bye, Bangkok.
On Bangkok Bound next week, the inside track on Thailand's infamous full moon parties. And the woman who's travelling to visit her son who is sentenced to 50 years in prison for heroin smuggling. People from Britain travel to Bangkok, the gateway to Thailand. Amongst them this week, ravers flocking to a full moon party, our man in Bangkok, the British consul, plus the woman off to visit her son, who's in prison for heroin smuggling. ...600 kilometres south of Bangkok in the Gulf of Thailand is the island of Koh Phan Yang. It's smaller than the Isle of Wight and has a population of just 10,000. There are no girly bars here and it's not a package destination. It is, however, a mecca for backpackers. Each month the local population almost doubles as visitors descend on the island for its infamous full moon parties. What started as low-key gatherings on the beaches 12 years ago has gained momentum. Now up to 8,000 people of all ages come together here every month to party until sunrise. 47-year-old Maria from South London is heading there. She's a grandmother of two and has joined her friend Harriet on a journey she's wanted to make since she first heard about the parties over 10 years ago.
I'm ancient old for this kind of
Robin,
thing.
I've left a huge family behind. Yeah. Children,
hello,
grandchildren,
family.
Surrogate children, yes. The lot. They're all left behind, crying at the airport. Don't leave me. Yeah. Bye-bye. Aww. Bye-bye. About the most adventurous thing holiday-wise I've done. Normally I'd go to the Mediterranean or something like that. Have a nice, easy time. But this is like definitely the most adventurous thing.
Totally.
That I've tried for years. I went to Morocco when I was young, you know, the hippie trail and all that.
So this is the second sort of hippie nation of the world.
Yeah.
It's so weird for me.
Yes.
Channel 4, you'll be allowed to broadcast, though, won't you? Channel 4.
What, she gets a what?
Everyone knows what I do.
Anyway. Yes.
smoke.
Might have to edit that bit.
For the Betsy Constabulary know what I'm doing anyway,
yes,
don't they?
Exactly,
I'm not moving.
Maria is immersed in the music scene back home.
Maria is a DJ herself.
Yes, I promote a drum and bass rave in South London called Steppers. So I've got a reputation within the drum and bass world. You know, a lot of young people come to my house to learn to DJ using mine and my son's vinyls.
One of the reasons I came out here is because I'm waiting for an operation at the end of March when I get back on my hips that have been replaced before, but it's all gone wrong, so they need replacing again. So I thought, right, let's get away for a nice few weeks before I'm confined to a non-movement for 6 months or whatever it'll take.
The pair settle into their bungalows and psych themselves up for the party.
7 hours till the full moon party, Harriet.
Yes. Yeah, so perhaps I should start getting ready like in an hour.
No. I imagine it's Glastonbury on the beach kind of thing, without all the tents.
Without
the tents,
yeah. It is kind of like that, I suppose, yeah.
Being on crutches will not impair my night tonight.
We'll be chucking these in the sea.
They'll end up in some dark corner being very lonely by themselves. Yeah. It's really funny because I can't walk properly. And so I'll be there and I'll be, you know, giving it some, and everyone, gosh, she's
without
all right.
The sticks.
She's all right. And then I've got to go and get a drink. Hey, someone, where's my sticks? I need to walk.
As well as tourists, there are many Westerners who've made the island their home, like 29-year-old Steve, originally from Bracknell. He first came to the island 11 years ago and moved here for good last September. He says he was drawn here by the island's unique atmosphere.
There's a magical feel to this place. It's beautiful. The physical environment, the people are wonderful, the food is great, and the weather's fantastic. And it draws people from all around the world. I don't know quite what happened, but I became very spiritual. Came from within, but it helped to be surrounded by people, I guess, like myself, who are natural in this way, and it helped to bring out things in me that maybe, well, I think I always knew they were there. So coming here last year did change my life, for sure. And I mean, I never look back. You know, it's just onwards and upwards, and every day gets better for me.
Although the cost of living's low here, Steve needs an income, so he's decided to open a restaurant with a group of friends he met here. It's only cost him £5,000 to get it off the ground.
Today we signed a contract to set up our first business, our first company, which is amazing for me because I've been talking about it for about the last 10 years. And my mum and dad are watching us, so I say, there you go, I actually did it. What can I say? I'm very proud at this moment.
Steve will be celebrating his new venture at the full moon party tonight.
Just have so much fun. It's just, you're going to see so many characters, you're going to see so much colour and fantastic music, great energy, especially in the morning when you can actually see everyone's faces when the first light comes. It's just classic, you know.
Another British person who's made the island his home is 27-year-old Chris Meller from Bath. He's been visiting the island for 2 years, but moved here last September. He wanted to escape the British winter, but the main reason he's here is that once a month at the full moon party, he gets to fulfil his passion, DJing.
The enjoyment I get is from seeing people dance in front of me. That's always been the main buzz for me. To see 1,000, 2,000 people that I've never met before, all dancing, having a good time, getting their smiles, all the rest, that's worth it for me.
He doesn't get paid for DJing, but instead scrapes a living running a small bar next to a group of tourist bungalows.
When I first started DJing, I wanted to be famous. I think every DJ does. And in England, it's not going to happen unless you're on the scene right from the beginning. It's not going to happen. Whereas out here, you know, I think I've achieved what I wanted. The thing is, everyone sees this as the party island, and this is the place to come and get off your head.
Although Thailand's infamous full moon parties were once associated with Class A dance drugs and marijuana, the government has cracked down heavily on blatant drug use using tough and controversial police tactics.
You can't smoke at the full moons. It was like that a few years ago. Everybody could sit around smoking. The police would probably come and smoke with you. However, these days, you just can't do it. There's so many undercovers there. They'll sit there, they'll roll a joint, and they'll pass it to, or they'll ask you if you'd like a toke on it. They'll pass the joint to you, and when you take the joint, you suddenly find a pair of handcuffs on your wrist.
This has led to an arguably more dangerous substitute being taken by many of the partygoers.
Quite a lot of people at the full moons will indulge in things from the pharmacies.
The most popular drug of choice at the parties is amphetamine-based diet pills. It's technically illegal for pharmacies to sell them without a prescription, but many ignore the rules, making big profits.
Yeah, you think about the quantity of diet pills that's required to fuel, say, 3,000 people, and as they're making 2,000% profit on each one sold, they're making an absolute killing.
4 hours to go before the party starts, and Chris plans his set using records he's brought from home.
This month's going to be a bloody good party. There's a lot of people on the island. Everybody's up for a real stormer. And I've got some fine, fine tunes in my record case.
The evening begins with partygoers flocking to the bars that line the main beach on the island. Each bar has its own sound system and lineup of DJs, all out to please the crowds, a large portion of which are British.
Basically, just a shag fest. Can't beat Pope and Yang for a good time.
What a good time.
Happy. Pope and Yang.
I'm here in Koh Phangan to basically have sex.
Yeah.
During Chris's set, Maria's disability has temporarily gone away.
The music takes me over and the atmosphere takes me over, and it is remarkable how I can dance.
While Steve celebrates his new business venture. An hour later, Chris comes off the decks and is ready to party.
Set went absolutely fantastically. And now I'm going to get a few beers down my neck and go and join in with a party, go and see all my friends. Anyway, I'll see you later.
As the sun rises, the party is in full flow. And Maria is still on her feet.
Exactly what hippies were like back in my day. I'm so happy, you know, that I've finally done what I set out to do over 20 years ago.
As the party winds down, the ravers prepare to sleep, as does the island. Until next month. When British people are in trouble in Thailand, the man they can turn to is Brian Kelly, the British consul who's based in Bangkok. His job often involves helping people who've lost their passports or money, but he also has to deal with the problems arising from people getting involved with drugs. Last year alone, 40 Brits were arrested on Koh Phangan for smoking joints. For most, it meant a fine and deportation.
Any kind of involvement with drugs in Thailand is very stupid, because you get arrested and fined and then you end up in a place called Immigration Detention Centre. But what isn't generally realised that if you're deported from Thailand, you have a stamp on your passport. And a lot of people, they have to cancel their holiday, because once they've got this stamp in their passport, forget going to Australia, New Zealand, the United States. The only place they can go is back to the UK. Sadly, we have people in prison here who are doing long sentences. Some cases, 40-year sentences for trafficking in heroin. We do all we can to help these people. We visit them every month.
In addition to drugs, another problem facing the Thai authorities is the influx of paedophiles.
There has been, in the last couple of years, a big clampdown in Thailand on sex crime, particularly crime against children. And in fact, the United Kingdom has trained Thai police officers. We've sent experts out from the United Kingdom and dealing with such cases and training the Thai police in how to handle these cases. And we have a very good cooperation with the Thai police. So I suppose the message is that pedophiles should keep away from Thailand.
Ryan has two main pieces of advice for anyone planning to visit the country.
I should perhaps emphasise that you shouldn't leave home without travel insurance. There is no national health service here in Thailand. Travellers should ensure that their insurance covers covers medical treatment, including evacuation to the UK.
His second piece of advice is given in the light of figures which estimate there are 600,000 people who are HIV positive in Thailand.
If you are going to have sex in Thailand, use a condom.
Brian's job has involved dealing with Sheila Bouquet's son, who was sentenced to 50 years in a Bangkok prison for heroin smuggling. After the break, Sheila visits her son in jail.
This is Earth. If you can decode this message, now is a good time to visit our planet. For there is an event taking place which we call the Millennium, and we will mark this event with one of our greatest rituals, the party. There will be millions of these parties taking place on Earth. Some will have what we call music. Some will have what we call dancing. Some parties will be very large, and some will be very small. Some will have people in strange costumes, and some will have people in even stranger costumes. But if the party doesn't serve one of these, you're either at the wrong party or on the wrong planet.
Sheila and Jerry Bouquet should be enjoying early retirement at home in Southampton, but all is not as it seems. Sheila's eldest son, Johnny, is serving a 50-year prison sentence in Bangkok's Bang Kwang prison for drug offences.
Before Johnny went to Thailand, he was a roofer. He was in the building trade. His dream was to go to Thailand. He went February or March of 93. And then he travelled down to Koh Samui and worked in hotels. He's a kickboxer, and Johnny, once a week, had a bout, and he used to earn money for this. Unfortunately, he gambled. He was in a gambling debt in Bangkok and agreed to take a bag.
The bag, however, contained 2 kilos of heroin, which has a London street value of almost £150,000.
He saw an opportunity of clearing the debt. I'm afraid he was set up as a mule. Information was passed to our government, and he was arrested at the airport. It's the biggest regret of Johnny's life.
Johnny is now 38, and Sheila, who has 2 other sons, hasn't seen him for more than 2 years. She's heading back to Bangkok for her 5th visit.
It's called the Land of Smiles, and I don't always feel like smiling. It is heartbreaking once you've seen them and you've got to walk away.
Sheila can't even phone Johnny, and her only means of contacting her son is by letter.
I write to Johnny every Monday, and he writes back to me every week to 10 days. One of Johnny's last letters here, he's saying, "I can't wait to see you, Mum. I'm looking forward to the moment when we can chat. Loves you tons, Mum. And once more, a very happy birthday to you. See you very soon." Well, I will see you very soon, Johnny. I fly a week today. I can't visit you the day I arrive, as it's a Friday. Saturday and Sunday, I'm afraid the prison's closed. But you wait, Monday morning, I'll be there. I'll sign in nice and early. I'll be there to see you. Love you, John. See you soon.
After a 12-hour flight from London, Sheila has arrived in a balmy Bangkok, and the tropical weather isn't to her liking.
It's so hot here, Johnny. Out of all the places in the world to get yourself stuck in, the humidity. I steam clean when I come to see you, my darling. But you're worth it, I'll always come. But you could have done this in some wonderful climate for me. I'm fat and old, I can't handle this heat. I will handle it. I should get used to it in 3 days. Anybody think I was a secret agent? Nobody'd believe it, but my passport number is 007. I think it's Miss Moneypenny, don't you?
With 2 days to fill before seeing Johnny, Sheila sets off to explore Bangkok again.
I feel I'm going to stay a happier, more buoyant person by integrating into the Thai society, seeing Thai culture, because I'll vegetate if I sit here in this hotel.
Well, here we are in the famous Patpong market, spending all our money here, aren't we? So if I have one elephant and one Buddha, how much is that? Go on then, I want a Buddha. Well, if I brought enough money with me, I've just put my money in the hotel safe.
Hello, hello. I'm going to start again with one of those. Lots to tell Johnny, won't I, when I see him, bless him. I wish he was here with me enjoying this. I really do.
Sheila still has another 24 hours to wait before the prison opens. To while away the hours, she decides to go sightseeing at this floating market, but can't keep her mind off Johnny.
Well, Johnny's day, I believe, begins about half past six in the morning, and they're woken up. Johnny is in the yard for 10 hours a day. He trades to make life a little better for himself in cheap tobacco and coffee. He teaches 8 students kickboxing. He always says to me, if Terry Waite and John McCarthy can be chained in their underwear to a wall for 5 to 7 years, then if I'm 10 hours in the yard, I can do something. Well, the prisoners are housed in a room, the average front room size, and they do cram as many as 47 in these rooms. TB is rife in there, and so is AIDS, but they share needles. I'm pleased to say Johnny doesn't use drugs, and God willing, he never gets TB. He is a survivor. I tell him he's very brave. He said, we all come in brave, Mum, but some can cope with the situation better than others. But it's so strong, the lady let me feel.
Although Sheila isn't ashamed of Johnny, she's apprehensive about telling strangers her son's in a Thai jail. And occasionally, her attempts to appear as an ordinary tourist don't work.
Welcome to Thailand.
Thank you very much.
Where are you from?
From England.
What's your name?
Sheila.
Sheila, nice to meet you,
nice
Sheila.
To meet you.
We have big one. We have many stars.
Or Chang, elephant size.
No, not elephant size. You're really sexy, you know.
Oh, thank you very much.
I like it. You look like Elizabeth Taylor. I give you 25% off. You're sexy.
I'm sexy.
Yeah, I like sexy. You have a nice body. I like very much.
So, I like your manner.
17 pounds.
17 pounds?
Yeah. How long you stay here?
For 4 weeks in Thailand.
Come here for business or vocation?
No, to see my son.
Your son. Your son does stay in Thailand?
He stays in Thailand.
Working or study?
Very long time stay in Thailand.
Is he happy?
I am not sure. Your king has him in one of his prisons.
Oh.
He make big mistake. He took opportunity to get money for a problem. And he has 50 years in Bangkok.
Sheila's wait to see Johnny is finally over. Today she'll see her son for the first time in more than 2 years.
This is the day I've been looking forward to, the reason I'm here in Bangkok to visit Johnny. I'm sorting out things that I've brought from England, presents for him. Things like baked beans and cheddar cheese, club biscuits, you know, I mean, things that he can't get here. A little taste of home.
Although Sheila will see Johnny, she'll not, however, be able to touch him. In fact, there are a number of frustrating restrictions to their meeting. Contact visits where prisoner and visitor can hug and sit next to each other are becoming increasingly rare.
It's not the ideal situation to visit a prisoner in this country because I suppose we're sort of 10, 12 foot away from each other. Each side is chicken wire and bars, so it would be impossible to touch a prisoner or hand him anything, even though you have to hand your bag in on arrival. So I'll be able to see him, but it'd be like visiting a monkey in the zoo, which I feel is also criminal. As a mother, I worry terribly about Johnny. I worry about all my kids. They're all special, they're all different. I think a mum cares for life. It's like a life sentence for the parents as well as for the person in the prison.
Johnny is one of 30 British citizens in Thai jails. Conditions are much more basic than in prisons back home. The only food served in Bang Quang is rice and fish heads. For other foods, they have to rely on donations from their families and charities. It's now time for Sheila to enter Bang Quang prison and discover how the last 2 years have treated Johnny.
It feels really special. It's a privilege to see him, even if I couldn't give him a hug. Johnny's looking fit and well from his kickboxing and from the money the family send for a better diet. His hair is quite long, it's not the prison cut anymore, and he's gone quite grey. I think I'd better stop now, as three guards have gone by in succession and looked at me, and I don't want problems for Johnny.
Johnny was 33 when he went into prison. His original sentence meant that he would be 83 when he was finally released, but there is hope of leniency.
Johnny was included in the last amnesty in 96 and had 7.5 years taken from his sentence of 50 years. He's now served 5.5 anyway. So that leaves him looking at about 38, 39. There's a big amnesty coming up this year for the King's 72nd birthday, December. So they take a nice big chunk of these years away. Johnny's not looking at very long. Johnny's not a wicked boy. He's an opportunist. He saw a way out of his financial problem. He's not a bad man. He's never been to prison in England. He hasn't done anything really wicked. No, he's not a criminal. He made the biggest mistake of his life, and he's paying for it with his life, I'm afraid. He's learning to cope, or he's learned to cope wonderfully well, so I must cope. All the worry in the world won't change it, but I care so much. But worrying, it won't stop any of this.
On the programme next week, the man searching the go-go bars of Thailand on behalf of his aunt, and the commander off to check out his millionaire's son's business interests. Every month, 40,000 people from Britain travel to Bangkok, the gateway to Thailand. On the show this week, the man visiting the go-go bars of Thailand in search of a maid for his aunt. The woman who left Barnsley to run a British bar in Pattaya. And the commander off to check out his millionaire son's business interests. David Hall is a property developer and tree surgeon who lives with his aunt, the widow of artist John Bratby, in her large house in Hastings. He's off to Thailand on holiday and to search for a Thai girl who he can persuade to come back to England with him and work as his aunt's au pair.
We've had a couple of English au pairs that work in which has not been too successful. So she's asked me would I try and find her a foreign au pair.
He says he'd bring me back one of those Thai ladies who just love to come and live here. Well, they can because there's a beautiful room for them. Well, if they want to live with me, that's just fine by me.
It's a room ready for the girl herself. So it's a new bed, new carpet, the room just painted out about 2 months ago.
I've been on my own for 7 years now. How I've kept this huge house going on my own, I just cannot think. I just cannot do all the cleaning and dusting and, the dust just gathers 4 inches high.
Dave has an unorthodox approach to sourcing a potential employee.
I shall go on to the go-go bars and get chatting to girls and people there and go from there.
Dave's theory is that life as an au pair in his aunt's house in Hastings, being paid £200 per month plus board and lodgings, is a better prospect than life as a prostitute working in a Thai go-go bar. So, with his bags packed and hopes high, Dave sets off on his mission. After arriving in Bangkok, David made the three-hour journey straight to the coastal resort of Pattaya, notorious for its array of go-go bars.
My main idea is to get an Oscar. If I can do that, I feel I've achieved something really good, you know what I mean? And also done someone, give someone else in the world a chance.
With his mission in mind, Dave gets ready for a night out in Pattaya as the hotel's entertainment kicks off with a British flavour.
I'm just going to stick my pampers on and all that'll be two shakes. Cheating hard. Oh, razzle the night, boys. Getting ready for the go-go bar. Oh, don't think we're going to go back tonight. Who knows? Babs, lighter, gold card, money. Tell you finish. Beer, key. That's it. Let's go.
And it doesn't take long before Dave gets sidetracked by a proposition from a Russian woman.
Me and Angela tonight, Russian girl, 11 o'clock.
Yeah. You know, mate. She's put it right bluntly on me here, this Russian bird. She's like, more or less said, like, tonight, 11 o'clock, me and you, no problem. And your friend, if he wants one and all, he's got another Russian friend.
After meeting up with some English friends, Dave spends the next week hitting the red light area of Pattaya in search of a suitable woman.
Pattaya is a sex town. Unless you like sex, don't come to Pattaya. Everybody's out here just waiting for one thing, drink, party, and sex.
You can have what you want in these go-go bars, you know what I mean? It's your choice, it's your pick, you know? You can have your fucking, your arse on top of your head and your head out of your bottom of your arse, you know what I mean? They still go with you, you know what I mean? I've got myself a girl for the first night. I've had about three or four different girls here so far, in the space of just over a week.
And tonight, Dave finds himself another. This girl he feels may be suitable for the job back home, so he takes her back to his hotel to get to know her better.
Got myself a nice little 21-year-old mate coming home with me tonight. Any eye of you, sweetheart, hey? Nice, lovely.
But will she be the right girl for the job? And does Dave really care? The following morning, Dave finds himself back to square one.
The girl took home and she was 21. I think her name was Bar. I got chatting to her about au pair, but the girl basically didn't understand English. Finding an au pair is not easy at the moment, you know. I reckon what I've been doing and what I've learnt so far, I think I've got a good chance of finding a decent enough girl to come back to be an au pair. It's finding a girl. It's not been as easy as I'd imagined, but just still go with it. I'm still going to go with it and just keep trying, you know.
The search for a maid in Pattaya goes on, but tonight there's another thing Dave's looking for.
We're off to the school myself, it's a nice marijuana, Thai stick. Here we go.
He's been tipped off about a local supplier who he's arranged to meet later that evening to do the deal.
10 minutes, no problem. Me and my friend, we sit here and a drink and we wait. Thank you.
Dave is risking a heavy fine and deportation if he's caught in possession of cannabis. Undeterred, he waits for the dealer to arrive.
Nice one, mate. Sit down, me. Yeah, blinding, mate, just scored a nice little bag and that. More tomorrow. Cheers.
Dave was also offered heroin and cocaine, which he declined.
Sorted out, look. Bit of this, mate, bit of Thai stick. Look, lovely, nice Thai stick. Look, lovely. They love it out here, mate, I'm telling you. Cocaine, heroin, no good for you. Fuck you up.
Yeah. Oh, fuck me, you put a lot in that, haven't you? You've had that one, look. Yeah. You've had that one. Oh,
wait. Mind me, sugar,
you know. Yeah. You held that one. Look at the size of that one. Cool. Oh, no wonder you're out of it.
Cool. Oh, oh,
I think I'll better try this one.
No, so did anyone pay for it now?
I'm only happy. You want to come to toilet?
No.
You want chop, 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 do it? You want to play with my plonker?
Can I go up, you know?
He's done with these ones, but my ones are right, look.
It's stuff.
Ready to go, mate.
Time is running out for Dave. He's still to find a girl willing to return to England with him to work as his aunt's au pair. He decides to try harder.
Oi, oi. Don't want to know, do they?
Yeah. Oh, that's lovely, that is. You come to England?
No.
Work for me?
No. No, mate.
You shy, no, you my new wife. My new wife.
After much searching, Dave's efforts seem to have paid off.
I met a girl called Mar. She's turned out to be suitable for the job. She works in the farm. She goes with people like most of the girls do, work in the farm, you know, because it's money. She has three children. She doesn't really want to do what she's got to do. She knows what she's doing. She's not stupid, but she's 29. She don't want to be sitting there when she's 35, still behind a bar for £1,000 a night for some big fat slob to sit himself over.
Ma is prepared to leave her three children behind and move to England for the promise of a better life.
All we can do now is apply for a visa, hope that she's 100% about it, get her a ticket, and then bring her home and let's give the girl a chance.
But before Dave has time to organise the paperwork, Ma goes off to meet one of her regular clients in Bangkok.
She has a certain client from Holland who comes over. In this case, it's been 4 days. This is why we've had a few delays.
While she's away, he receives a message about one of the properties he's trying to sell for his business back home, leaving him with a problem on his hands.
Unfortunately, I've got to return back to England today. I've had a fax from a state agent because I look like I've got a buyer to buy my place Tuesday. Otherwise, I'd stay on for another 2-3 weeks and try and sort out Ma.
This means that Ma will have to organise the visa on her own when she returns from Bangkok.
I've written a letter for her, and one for a reference for a visa. All being well, hopefully she can come to England in a month's time. And all I can do is just hope that she keeps by her word. Let's pray that it all turns out for the better.
But what Dave's aunt's going to say when he returns home alone remains to be seen. A month later, back in Hastings, Dave is still waiting for the paperwork to be sorted out, and his aunt is still struggling on with the cleaning herself, but she remains optimistic.
He never phoned me, he never sent me a postcard, nothing. Because he was having too bloody a good time. Oh, darling love. He's met this lovely girl, and he's hoping that he will bring her back. Oh, she's going to like me and I'm going to like her. She won't be able to resist me, will she? Oh, darling.
Dave is currently back in Pattaya trying to sort out Ma's visa. He still hopes to bring her to Britain later this summer. With so many British people travelling to Pattaya, it's no surprise that some enterprising Brits are opening bars in the resort. 25-year-old Jenny came to Thailand on holiday from Barnsley in Yorkshire 3 years ago. She liked it so much that she left her home and family and bought into an English restaurant in Pattaya.
180!
Fish and chips and roast beef are top of the menu at Mick's place.
I lived in Bangalore for 25 years. I became a forklift driver.
And I used to work every day, and then I decided I wanted an holiday, so I came to Thailand. The way I talk now is I talk really, really slow, because when you talk to Thai people in English, you have to speak really slow. But the minute I go back to England to see my family, I talk, no problem.
There we go.
To be honest, I don't miss anything about England. Things are expensive, the weather's cold. I don't miss anything, I'd rather be here. The food that we serve in Mixed Place, you can either get fish or chips, you can have steak kidney pie, mashed potatoes, peas, carrots. Anything you can buy in England, you can buy here. The only things we cannot get is HP brown sauce, gravy granules, pistol gravy granules, English tea bags. But when I go back to see my family, I bring with me, so we've always got a supply. The fish and chips here are the best fish and chips you will ever taste in your life. Guaranteed.
I come to this place every day whilst I'm here to mix, and the food is beautiful. Yeah.
What did I have for breakfast?
Yeah.
What a calls were.
Pattaya's girly bars are obviously one of the seaside town's biggest attractions. But when British men take a break from exploring the streets, they head to bars like Mixed Place.
The girls, yes. Beautiful, beautiful ladies. Beautiful ladies in Pattaya.
The girls, they're beautiful. It's perfect choice, you don't know where to look. Some nights you have to have a rest.
Girls are very nice, but when you're married, you've got to keep away from them, haven't you? You know.
Pattaya is absolutely brilliant. People, bars, nightlife, everything. It's really good. Beach, Spain, anywhere. Best place in the world.
And I would not go back to England for anybody.
Coming up after the break, the commander who's off to see his millionaire son. And Neri Grove are going to Bangkok for 2 months to visit their son Jan, who lives and works there.
Well, here we are in Kensington. We do enjoy, shall we say, a better standard of living than the norm. And this is our house up here. I'm a retired lieutenant commander of the Navy, and I was an attaché in the British Embassy in Tokyo for a total of 6 years. I was a Japanese interpreter. I scored the highest rate ever, which was 88% in the final exams. Here is a Japanese naval sword. I, of course, was in the Navy. And I then retired from the Navy and became a stockbroker. I was the biggest seller of guilty. I was doing £1 billion a year with a staff of 4, can you believe it?
He was working in Japan. I was working in England because I do not believe in boarding schools.
The commander's son is the fifth generation of the Grove family to have business interests in the East.
And I think he takes his brains from his dad.
Yeah, he does. But also, I get on very well with people, and even long before I met her, when I went abroad first time, and I got on with Chinese, Indians, what have you, Africans, at a time when it was not fashionable.
Jan runs a car parking business, and the commander wants to meet his son's employees to make sure the company is weathering the Asian economic storm.
I am a director and a 10% shareholder, a six-figure shareholder, let's put it this way, in his business. So he's done bloody well. He's going to do even better.
You mustn't use perfect.
Of course I can. I'm a naval officer. I'll put on my nice Thai hat, which keeps the sun out. And then I've got a chin strap here if the wind is strong.
And what was that remark, Dr. Livingstone?
No, that's Africa. Nothing to do with me. I'm Asia.
In Bangkok, the commander and his wife are staying in their son's luxury 23rd floor apartment.
Well, as you can see, although this is a very exclusive area with embassies down there, expensive apartment blocks just a stone's throw away, right beside them are these slums.
The commander's son, Jan, is 33 and came to Bangkok when he spotted a gap in the car parking market.
I used to be a stockbroker in Tokyo. I came to Bangkok 4 years ago with a black bag, typical sort of immigrant story. I didn't know anybody here. I didn't speak a word of the language. Now I'm the largest car park operator in Bangkok. My parents are settling in fantastically. They love it here because they're waited on hand and foot.
Thank you.
My father is interested to see how his investments are going.
Jan has organized a morale-boosting company trip to Pattaya and takes his parents along to meet the staff.
In the Far East, if you're running a company, as I did for 20 years, you're the father figure. You treat them very equally, but they treat you with respect, which is not what would be the case necessarily west of Suez.
First stop is the shooting range. Next stop is a go-kart track where the commander takes a break from the action and orders himself a carrot juice.
I have not got my carrot juice yet. Keep those, I'll go and chase the man. Well, have you asked him where my carrot juice is? What? I think you're bloody long time. That's all right, okay. That's not carrot juice. That's not carrot juice. I can't eat solid carrot. No, I'm sorry. Tossapon was drinking it. I said, what is it? It looked good. It's a carrot juice. I ordered one.
The carrot juice finally arrives.
Well, is it juice? Hold on, let's try. That's not juice. That's solid. Look. That's ice. I see. All right. Well, I'll do my best.
After paying a large sum of money for the land rights around Morchit bus station, Jan profits from virtually all business taking place there. But he still needs to convince his father that the venture will recoup its investment.
Because the Thais never developed the rail network, all of the Thais are obliged to travel by bus. So this is in fact the largest bus terminal on earth.
Very easily, yes.
So that's 45 million people a year passing through this terminal.
Unbelievable, yeah.
All of these buses are waiting to drive into the terminal to pick up passengers. So they'll come into my land, park under the expressway here. For that, they pay a 50 baht parking fee.
Yeah.
All these shops you see over here, they're paying us. But we have a monopoly on all soft drink sales, beer, cigarettes, magazines, newspapers. Each car has to pay 15 baht per hour. That's right, that's also my bus wash. We also have a snooker club over there. I have the right for all the advertising contracts within this building.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you, that toilet over there does an absolute cracking business. 2 baht to use the loo.
Well,
you know, we're doing about 3 to 3,500 pounds a day, so it's really turning in the cash now.
Jan's successful venture takes the commander back to the days of the empire.
What my son has done is what English people that age could have done in the 18th or 19th centuries, and most of them haven't got it together anymore, can't be done. The place to get it done, as it was in those days, is the East. Hooray, my spectators arrived, and a video of English television has arrived. So that keeps you busy for a few days.
The commander and his wife have settled in well to life in Thailand, and while their son tries to strike a business deal over advertising space with a Japanese company, the couple head off to lunch at the British Club.
Oh, Jap. It's obviously that blue building. Nearly, wait.
No.
I tell you, wait a minute, nearly, I don't think this, no, more, wait, maybe here, let me look, slow, yes, I think this is it, open your window and give them this, yes, we are honorary members. Sorry.
Like his father, Jan speaks Japanese, which gives him an advantage during deals like this.
I think it's invaluable that my upbringing meant that I was in Asia since the age of three, because it allows me to understand some of the cultural methods of doing business and of getting along with people.
After a stressful journey, the couple eventually arrive at the British Club. And after sorting out his lunch arrangements, the commander reflects on his son's business achievements, which are improving by the minute.
Okay, we got it. So out for a few beers tonight. The deal went ahead. They're going to pay 90,000 in advance, and they're going to pay about 2,000 to 3,000 each month. So that's fantastic news. Dad's going to be very pleased. And we're now in advertising.
So Jan follows in his father's footsteps, conquering the East.
I wouldn't mind spending 6 months a year here, you know, 6 months in Britain. I'm a bit sort of schizophrenic, I suppose. If I can quote Kipling, ship me somewheres east of Suez, where the best is like the worst, where there ain't no Ten Commandments, and a man can raise a thirst.
On the programme next week, the former fireman who's off to net himself some butterflies, the widow who's swapping her comfortable home life to work in an orphanage, and the former rock star who's opted for the simple life. Is going to Chiang Mai to net what he describes as Thailand's most beautiful creatures. Despite being married for 40 years, his wife approves of his passion and will even be accompanying him on his latest trip.
In recent years, I've been specialising in putting together a collection of tropical butterflies. I did well over 30 years as a serving farmer and retired to pursue my hobby.
Well, this is where all the butterflies finish up into the cabinets.
Sid's off to northern Thailand to fill up gaps in his collection. In particular, he'd love to catch an impressive troilus butterfly known as the birdwing.
Naturally, the large butterflies, the birdwings, are the eye catchers. And if you see one, the heart does pound a bit, I must admit. They are fantastic.
Malaysia, Borneo, India, Thailand. Yeah, always looking to get a complete setup, you know, with a male, female and the underside and that.
When Sid dies, it's his wish that his collection of over 2,000 butterflies be left to the British Museum.
This is a group of butterflies belong to the family Delius. Once again, as you can see, they're mostly in threes. But sometimes you get variations. Now, the butterfly will then be pinned through the body once it's been killed and accepted for the collection. Just an ordinary plain white on the upper side, but a very colourful underside. This is the killing jar. Inside is a proprietary killing fluid, which I take off the lid and tip in a few drops, replace the lid. Now that liquid then gases off into a gas. So it's from a liquid to a gas. It's now a lethal chamber. You need a long net because tropical butterflies are very active, where you can manoeuvre the butterfly net at a downward stroke on that, and then as you get closer to that, because they'll be out, they go down. Well, we're all packed up now, ready to go, so I'll proceed with shutting the cases. And away we go. Right, bye-bye house. See you in 3.5 weeks.
After a 14-hour journey, Sid and his wife arrive in Chiang Mai, which is just over 700 kilometres north of Bangkok.
Chiang Mai, of course, is one of these cities that's getting larger and bigger all the time. And it's now the second largest city in Thailand after Bangkok. But it's still a nice place. A lot of it is still undisturbed.
Sid heads off into the jungle surrounding his hotel in search of butterflies, in particular the birdwing.
Right, here we are, Chiang Mai. Here we come. So we're going off to an elephant trekking camp, which is lots of jungle, some elephant trials and so on. So let's go for it. Right, okay. See you later. Okay. I'll leave the door. Oh, better close it for the film. Okay. Right, here we go. Chiang Mai is surrounded with hills and beautiful countryside. And these are often good places, you know, to find wildlife. But I must say, it's great to be back in the jungle. I don't know, I've never born in the jungle, but I'm born in London, but it's nice to be back, you know.
Two things seem to be working against Sid. At this time of year, there aren't many butterflies, and the lack of sunlight means the butterflies that are there are hiding.
At the moment, we seem to have a double whammy, but hopefully it will heat up a little later when the sun comes out. But that's how it goes, you know. Well, we're just passing a good illustration of elephant droppings. As you can see, it's very fibrous, and it's almost all vegetable matter. There's no smell, really, unlike some other, you know, dog perhaps. We have quite a bit of smell sometimes. Something else I failed to mention was I always carry a few tissue papers with me into the forest and so on, because one never knows if you're going to get caught short, and there's not much growing on the bushes, so it's leaves I have used, but this is much better.
As a law-abiding citizen, Sid hunts in accordance with the regulations. He's not allowed to bring home live butterflies, it's forbidden to kill or capture endangered species, and he's not allowed to net them with intent to sell.
It's something I've enjoyed all my life. I enjoy all forms of wildlife, and I'm all for protection of the countryside and the continuing existence of wildlife.
Classic miss. Nine times out of ten.
You've got to be quite patient when you're doing this. Eyes all over the place. It's a constant looking around as you go through. Apart from looking out from where your feet's going, I'm always falling down or tripping over and slipping on muddy sections and that, so you've really got to have good eyesight.
It's a frustrating start for Sid, who's not managed to catch anything and hasn't even had a sighting of the elusive birdwing. The sun has come out, and Sid divulges a trick of the butterfly collector's trade.
Human urine is very attractive to butterflies, and of course it's not unknown for some collectors, particularly in the tropics, to put some bait down.
The improved weather means there are plenty of butterflies around, but catching them is a different matter.
Oh, missed.
Patience is the key.
Usual technique, admire the butterfly, looks perfectly all right, in good condition, slowly lower the net. No, he's just walking about inside the net, wondering what's happened. In the Neptis group of butterflies, he's in perfect condition.
After finally netting some butterflies, things get even better for Sid when he spots a large female birdwing.
He saw me, or she in this, is a female. This calls for two poles. Coming down slowly but surely. They can be up to 8 inches across the wing, some of them. Down here, men, X marks, spot. Do you hear me? Down here. There you see him, now you don't. Well, I think we're gonna have to give that one a miss, unfortunately. There you are.
So another day's hunting comes to an end, and still no birdwing in Sid's net, but he'll be trying again tomorrow. It's coming to the end of the trip, and Sid decides to find a remote waterfall where pickings may be rich.
God, some of this undergrowth and top growth
Just trying to have a look, see where I've come out at. I've had to go through a bit of thicket, and sometimes it's worth it. You never know. Because you're always looking around for new places. And we came up on this one this morning, so we'll give it a go. That is proving to be aesthetically fruitful, and also it's producing the odd butterfly, and I'm certainly seeing more than I'm catching, but it's great to just to see them.
Sid spots a butterfly he's been after for a while.
I'm going to keep this one because it's in quite good condition.
He has to kill the butterfly by pinching it on the thorax because it's too big for the killing jar.
So this one will be killed. I'll give it an extra pinch. Take this home to Surrey. And see what a nice specimen it is.
It's the end of the last day, and despite netting some good specimens for his collection, the birdwing butterfly has eluded Sid, but he seems to have enjoyed himself.
Well, this has been really lovely here. I'll say farewell for the moment and pick up my bag. Now the butterflies are safe. Now I shall lie in bed tonight thinking of all those beautiful butterflies I've seen. Ah, I should have been that much quicker. I should have done this, should have done that. But there you go. Goodbye, beautiful place. I suppose if they gave themselves up every time, there wouldn't be that much fun in it.
Coming up after the break, the woman who left home to work in an orphanage, and the former pop star who swapped the showbiz world for the quiet life.
Zou het niet handig zijn als je op elk moment, waar ook ter wereld, informatie van internet kon halen? Dat kan met WAP op je mobiel. Binnenkort kun je mobiel internetten op je Motorola.
December, alle acties van het afgelopen jaar nog één keer op herhaling. Mooi van Hans Anders.
Zuster Sam.
Nee, nu even niet.
Hé? Hallo?
Hey Maarten, gaat het goed met je? Met mij wel hoor, dag.
Rijk, wat een belachelijk kort gesprek. Ik bedoel, van jou in Alkmaar naar mij hier in Amsterdam. Dat kost maar 6 cent per minuut.
Oh, dan kan is je toch zo goedkoop?
Ja.
In dat geval, vertel Maarten. Leuk ziekenhuis?
Nou.
Hulpzame nachtzusters? Wacht even. Pak er een bakje koffie bij. Blijf even hangen.
I can't go home!
Remember, fundamentally, people are suckers for the truth. And the truth is on your side, Bubba.
En met voordeelnummers belt u nog eens 10% voordeliger. Bel de zelfservicelijn 0800 0429. KPN Telecom.
Audrey Williams is a 57-year-old widow living alone in Devon. She's decided to leave behind her life in Britain to go and work in a Thai orphanage for a year.
My husband died 3 years ago, and then I had a choice. You know, I either sit in a corner and cry my eyes out and complain about what I've lost, or I'm grateful for what I had and got on with life, and that's what I chose to do. And one thing I'd always wanted to do was to sponsor a child in a third world country. So anyway, I saw a tiny advert for Father Brennan's orphanage in Thailand. Anyway, I sent away and got the details about one little boy. Thought, this isn't good enough. What a child really needs is somebody to be there to say, you're special and, you know, you're important to me. So I wrote to Father Brennan and I got a letter back saying, yes, I was welcome to come. I actually stayed for 4 months. The last week I was there, I was going to sleep crying, I was waking up in the night crying. It was dreadful. And then I realised what it was, I'd fallen in love. And I'd fallen in love with over 600 people and a place, and it just, fantastic.
She's letting out her house while she's away and is eager to leave for Thailand to be at the orphanage in time for the biannual group photograph of all the residents.
Okay. Yeah.
Seventeen hours later, and Audrey has reached Pattaya. There are over 600 people at the orphanage, which, as well as having a home for orphans, also has a centre for elderly and disabled people, blind and deaf homes, and a centre for street children.
Hello, good to see you. Hi, hello, I remember you. Oh. Do you think of a better reason for coming back?
I can't do it.
The orphanage was set up 26 years ago by Father Ray Brennan from Chicago.
You haven't changed a bit.
Good to see you.
Good to see you. Are we disturbing your lunch?
No.
It's good to
welcome back.
You. Thank you.
He's a priest. He came down to Pattaya when it was just a small, quiet village. Somebody left a baby at the church. And then the news got around that there was some place you could leave your babies. And, I mean, over the years now, he must have had thousands of children passing through.
I'm glad to see you back.
Oh, right. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's nice to be welcomed, isn't it?
Yeah.
Audrey doesn't get any pay at all, but she receives food and basic accommodation in the old people's quarters, which are a far cry from home.
This is my beautiful loo. What you have to do is use this bucket of water to flush things. It's also where I can shampoo my hair by pouring buckets of water.
One of the places Audrey will be working is the baby home, where up to 30 babies live. Some are referred by social and church organisations, while others are left anonymously.
You don't remember me, do you? No. You sing a little song.
Well, whenever I had a spare moment, I'd be in here. I'd come in about 6 o'clock and tuck them all up and say goodnight, God bless to them all.
Did you want to be a movie star? I've known him since he was a week old. And he's coming out, it'll be a year, 17th of December. I understand he's been for adoption at the end of this year, the beginning of next year. And I don't know how I'm going to feel about that. Yeah. Yeah, it'd be good for you. I just dread to think of where they would be if it wasn't for this orphanage. And they're well looked after and well loved.
After her emotional reunion in the baby unit, Audrey goes to the old people's home to track down Auntie Lily, an elderly, blind and disabled Burmese woman. The pair grew very close during Audrey's last visit.
Anybody here? Is anybody here? Who's this?
Seeing Auntie again is really good.
Who's this one?
She's a great delight to be with.
Audrey. It's me. I've waited a long time for you.
I know.
A long time.
I know.
How are you?
Why do you want me to put on my hearing aid?
So you can hear what I'm saying to you.
When you sit near me, I can hear everything, my darling.
Can you?
She's originally from Burma.
You sit down.
Okay.
And she has no family.
Miss you like anything.
I missed you very much.
I always
much.
Think of you every night when I'm going to sleep.
She came over to Bangkok and was teaching for a while. And her eyesight started to go, and the church in Bangkok, the bishop, sent her down to live with Father Ray.
You're not going to be depressed anymore, are you?
If I have you near me, I don't think I'll be depressed anymore, my darling.
She's 85 years old, on November the 11th this year.
Oh, everyone sends their love.
Another part of the orphanage provides a refuge for homeless children.
This boy is one of the boys I sponsor. He's grown so much. Last time I saw him, he was a young man there. Look at that little girl. She's beautiful. And who knows what's happened to her in life. It takes him a while to realise that there are people who can genuinely just love them in the right sort of way.
The day Audrey has been looking forward to is approaching.
Tomorrow morning at the crack of dawn, there'll be over 600 people here having the group photograph taken. It should take some arranging. It's now 7:45. They were hoping to have this done by 7:30 this morning or earlier, but there's so many people it takes a long time to get it organised. So probably by about 8:00 we should be on the road. There's over 600 people here. Everyone's actually here, it's just a matter of positioning them now. Father Ray, rather than stay in the picture himself, stands behind the camera, jumping up and down, flapping his arms, makes everybody laugh.
Okay, set my.
Let me see.
Set my. Bong for Ray! Bong for Ray!
After 4 weeks here, Audrey's convinced she's made the right decision.
I'm happy. I wouldn't be here if I wasn't. It's total contentment. It's because I know I should be here. This is what I'm meant to be. I don't know why or what good I'm going to be, but I know I'm here for a purpose. And it doesn't really matter if I know what it is or not.
As Audrey settles into her new life in Thailand, she joins an estimated 6,000 British expats. Adrian Fisher is a guitarist and former rock star who lives on the island of Koh Samui. He gave up his rock and roll lifestyle to live a simple life when he split from top 80s pop group Sparks with the brothers Ron and Russell Mayle.
When I first met the brothers, I mean, they weren't like they were now. I mean, Ron used to look like Frank Zappa, beard and long hair and stuff, and he just turned up one day looking like Hitler. And I think the image was supposed to be some 1920s Playboy kind of image.
After becoming disillusioned with the music industry, Adrian decided to look for something else.
I was getting so depressed I had to go somewhere. I just kind of literally sort of went, Thailand, I haven't been there before, and that's like 3 days turned into about 3 weeks or a month. I eventually made it here, and I've been here ever since, I guess. Six and a half years. And I see something that surprises me every day, especially in Samui, where tourism is actually fairly new, but they're catching on real fast, supermarkets, internet, cafes, and it's all very strange. I mean, I've been here 6 years, you can imagine how strange it is for guys that I know have been here for 12, 15 years. I mean, I mean, there wasn't a road here, it's the track, and there was like just a few bars, and that was it. I mean, every time I blink, there's a new bar here. I mean, if in doubt, they stick up a new bar and knock another one down. Quite hate the girly bars, and I said, like, hello, welcome, come inside, handsome man. Sure. I hate all that. It's one thing I don't like, seeing like a 65, 70-year-old man walking down the street with a 18-year-old girl and stuff. It was kind of, it's not right somehow.
Rock and roll excess. I was lucky, been there, seen, done most of it. Survived it. And it wasn't so long ago I had a severe alcohol problem here. And it's easy done, it's cheap. You just don't realise you're doing it. You've got good friends saying, hey, you're losing the plot. You can play guitar when you're pissed, and you can play guitar when you're sober. But I know, I'm not that much of a dummy. I know I play much better when I'm sober. Don't drink any heavy stuff, a couple of beers. I don't mind losing anything, but I don't want to lose my dignity. And walking like that home at night and falling in puddles and stuff, that's... I don't want to do that anymore. I'm too old to go running around in the dirt.
You better come on in my kitchen. It's gonna be a rain mess. The woman I love is my best friend.
One of the main ties I have in Thailand, pun intended, is my girlfriend, same age as me. I don't hang out with young girls and stuff. She's done so much for me. She's taken care of me. I hate to admit it, she supports me sometimes. It should be the other way around. It's very unusual to find a Thai lady with that attitude, who's that devoted, who basically has faith in your ability. Without her judge of character and guidance and knowledge, I couldn't survive here on my own. No way. Rags to riches, riches to rags, but surviving. It's only rock and roll, but I'm getting the hang of it.
Op net 5 in de Western Hengen.
We gaan ons wassen. Nice shoes.
Vorige week begonnen we onze reis in de metropool Bangkok, waar ik als eerste een Thaise bokswedstrijd bezocht. Na een avondje doorzakken met een stel backpackers, stapte we de volgende dag in een longtailboot om Bangkok vanaf het water te bekijken. En bezocht ik een tempel waar ik sprak met een jonge monnik. Ten slotte vertrokken we te voet voor een tweedaagse jungle trekking om een bezoek te brengen aan een traditioneel bergvolk wat nog geheel primitief in bamboehutten leeft. In deze aflevering van Arrivals reizen we verder door de jungle, waarna we in Chiang Mai het vliegtuig nemen naar Koh Samui, een van de vele mooie eilanden die Thailand rijk is. Met de boot gaan we door naar Koh Phangan, een eiland dat bekend staat om zijn vele goede feesten. Ik beland er op een Black Moon Party. En met een duf hoofd varen we de volgende dag naar Koh Tao, waar ik ga duiken. Met een nachtboot gaan we vervolgens naar Surathani. En van daaruit reizen we terug naar Bangkok. Het is nog erg vroeg als we de volgende morgen het dorp alweer verlaten. Ik ben doodop en gebroken, want ik heb die nacht met een paar gekneusde ribben en een gare rug op een keiharde vloer geslapen en bijna geen oog dicht gedaan. Maar het is een prachtige tocht.
Mooie hoed, hè?
Leuke hoed.
Weer gemaakt. Dat hebben ze voor me gemaakt. Hey, daar zijn ze.
Oh, dat is
Gids Chang. Het zijn boomkevers. Ze zijn nu dood en dan worden ze hier in Thailand gebruikt als juwelen. Niet te geloven, hè? Maar we gaan wel lopen. Het laatste deel van de tocht. Kom, let's go.
Delicious. Gorgeous. You want to try? Yummy.
I had a gorgeous breakfast this morning.
Yeah? And what about the others?
But my cameraman is very adventurous type.
How about the cat? How is it?
A bit salty.
Zijn er. Mijn poot is zo stuk. Gestampen. Maar het was wel werkelijk briljant. Ik zit wel lekker slapen vandaag.
Het is alweer tijd om het noorden te verlaten en koers te zetten naar de eilanden in het zuiden. Koh Samui, Koh Phangan en Koh Tao. Zo hoort het vliegveld toch te zijn. Gewoon zonder muren, zonder airconditioning, zonder grijze wachtruimtes. Gewoon open, vrij in de tropen. De eerste toeristen arriveerden zo'n 30 jaar geleden per kokosnotenschip op Koh Samui. Inmiddels is het een van de meest populaire vakantiebestemmingen van Thailand door idyllische stranden, palmbomen en azuurblauw water. Helaas heeft die groei er ook voor gezorgd dat het op sommige plaatsen erg druk en commercieel is geworden. Het beste voorbeeld daarvan is het grootste plaatsje Chau Eng. Hier vind je ontelbare souvenirshops, kledingzaken, wisselkantoren en barretjes. Als ik even door het dorpje loop, wordt ook meteen duidelijk waar Koh Samui nog meer bekend om is. Het sekstoerisme. Het barsten van de bars waar westerlingen hun zogenaamde Thaise vakantievriendinnetjes tegen betaling kunnen oppikken. Nou, het gaat niet zo goed met Floortje, dus ik heb een beetje erg pijn. Ik begon natuurlijk met mijn kneuzing op een eerdere trip. Dat heb ik door mijn rug gezakt en daar kwam een pijn en tweedaagse trekking overheen. Dus ik moet maar even naar de dokter. Maar als je hier naar de dokter wil in Thailand, dan moet je eigenlijk meteen naar het ziekenhuis. Internationaal ziekenhuis. Ik ben er niet echt voor, maar ja, dat moet. Dat moet.
No medication?
No, no medication. Waarom moet ik nou gewogen worden? Thank you.
No problem.
What's the problem? I have I bruised my ribs a few weeks ago. Oh, am I being operated?
Nadat de dokter me gecheckt heeft, schrijft ze me een flinke dosis pijnstillers voor.
Het is echt heel goedkoop dit. Het medicijn kost me iets van 12 gulden en de dokter is maar een tientje. Hey, geweldige deal. Ik kan er wel van maken hier, voor de rest van de tijd. En ik vond het echt heel erg meevallen. Hier, hè? Ik wilde even bijkomen van alle drukte en alle toerisme in Chau Eng. En daarvoor heb ik de taxi genomen, een kwartiertje, in de buurt van Lamai. Er ligt namelijk een heel rustgevend oord. Ontspannen. Ook een slokje.
Mijn volgende bestemming is het buureiland Koh Phangan. Het ligt op een uur varen van Koh Samui en is erg populair bij backpackers. En dat komt vooral omdat hier op het strand elke maand de beroemde full moon parties gehouden worden. Maar ook al is het geen volle maan, er is altijd wel een of ander feest op dit eiland.
Dingen waar je vaker een beroep op doet, zoals huisarts en medicijnen, zijn